Investors locked in profits this week on tax-related selling ahead of the April 15th deadline. Hello, everyone. Your host, Chris Waltzek, back with you. We have another big show lined up for you this weekend with two big guests. Well, with gold shares staging a recovery so far this year, the head of Casey Research says that some precious metals companies could make you, well, virtually a millionaire. When asked if inflation or deflation is the biggest threat, his answer is yes. Either one could be on the horizon, sending the markets into chaos, making even the 2008 credit crisis seem tame by comparison. And forget the ETFs as a safe haven. He doesn't trust them. With less than 1 ounce of gold available for each global inhabitant, investors need to pick up physical gold at home and abroad using services like goldmoney.com. Next, top economic forecaster from Mercer University, Professor Roger Totaro, says hard assets, including the precious metals, can provide a solid inflation hedge. Although the 2011 to 2013 gold reaction was intense, the price is elevated due in part to their safe haven qualities. And we'd like for you to call in your questions and comments. We have a toll-free hotline available 24 hours a day. 7 days a week, you can leave your first name or remain anonymous if you prefer. The toll-free Q&A hotline, 1-800-507-6531. That number again, 800-507-6531. Please jot it down on a Post-it pad. Keep it near your phone or plug it or program it right into your cell phone or home phone. GoldSeek.com radio begins now with the market weather report. Cloudy skies persisted over the precious metals exchanges for the second week running on renewed rate hike concerns. Investors locked in some precious metals profits, preferring the sidelines amid the third consecutive Fed QE tapering. Gold is still higher, though, for the year by about 4 to 5%. At Friday's closing bell on the New York COMEX exchange, gold dropped less than $40, finishing just below $1,300. Silver lost less than half a dollar, finishing just shy of $20. Palladium dropped $20, ending at $775 an ounce. Platinum lost $25, ending at $1,412. But West Texas Intermediate crude bucked the trend, gaining $2, closing over the century mark at $101 per barrel. Well, the top story impacting the precious metals markets this week, better than anticipated domestic economic reports, which reduced the safe haven demand for the yellow metal. U.S. consumer spending increased in February at the fastest clip since November, and of course, that metric is widely considered the engine of the economy, responsible for more than 70% of our total output. In addition, weekly jobless claims declined to the lowest level in 4 months, and economic growth in the final 3 months of 2013 increased at about 3% annual pace, well above expectation. Investors viewed the positive news as good for the dollar and likely to encourage the Fed to continue with its tapering measures for the fourth consecutive round at the upcoming FOMC meeting. Plus, comments from the Fed indicate that we could see a rate hike as early as 2015. Nevertheless, another market pundit called for gold prices to reach $5,000 during this decade amid federal deficits and rising debts around the globe, as well as demographic trends, plus money printing and higher gold demand. And Jeremy Grantham, who correctly called the year 2000 equities bubble and the housing bubble, is warning his clients to avoid equities altogether, although there could still be some further upside, he says as much as 30%. Barclays Investment Bank also raised its gold forecast. Moving on, billionaire businessman T.S. Kalyanaraman reminds one of Ramanujan, the great mathematician, 26 years old, found by G.H. Hardy, expects gold imports to resume as the government of India lifts its import controls due to festivals and wedding demand. Import duties were increased 3 times last year to improve the balance of payments, in particular the current account deficit to support the rupee, the national currency. Renewed imports to propel India back to the position of largest gold consumer is expected due to massive gold smuggling, as spreads are as high as $160 over the London spot gold price. Put simply, these small gold jewelers in India are seeing their margins squeezed due to high premiums they must pay to procure gold and remain in business. China is currently the world's largest importer, but unlike China, which is also the world's largest gold producer, India imports virtually all of its gold. Kalyanaraman made the startling projection that once Indian gold curbs are dropped, national demand could soar as much as 50%. Since the smuggled gold transactions currently occur under the table outside of government tallies. Interestingly, demand for gold in Japan flew higher by 500% last month, ahead of an impending sales tax hike and the threat of further government stimulus measures. Bottom line on the precious metals. Well, after a three-month nap in their caves, the gold bears are awake and foraging. However, two down weeks only amounts to, I think, a reaction here amid a three-plus-month rally for the precious metals. Moving on to the Wall Street Report, partly cloudy skies appeared over the New York Stock Exchange following lackluster Fed stress test results on the banking sector. For the week, the Dow added 20 points, ending at about 16,323. The S&P 500 lost 9 points, ending at 1,857. NASDAQ fell from last week's 14-year record off about 121 points, ending at 4,155. The Federal Reserve stress test this week resulted with sharp gyrations throughout the global markets. I can attest to this. We saw on Friday a move of over 100 points to the upside, followed quickly by 150 points to the downside, all in the same session. This is where the Fed officials target the banking sector, and it resulted in sharp price sell-offs, over 5% in fact, for Citigroup shares. The annual bank checkup is required for institutions with more than $50 billion in assets. Fed officials noted that banking management practices are not solid enough to withstand a severe recession. 26 banks participated in the Fed's annual stress test, and they did earn the okay, though, for scheduled dividend payouts and share repurchases. The Fed has offered the banks about 90 days to resolve any other issues. The Fed's test scenario involved an increase in unemployment rate of about 11.2% and a 50% drop in equities prices, as well as a decline in home prices down to 2001 levels. Now, the Fed's balance sheet has ballooned to $4.3 trillion, a fivefold factor over the past 5 years. So with the threat of higher rates, just what could happen to their trillions of toxic debt on the balance sheet, and perhaps even to the Fed? Stay tuned. Bottom line, well, the 7-component market sentiment index reached a fear level this week. Still not really oversold for the time being. The markets are consolidating. So be sure to log into the Alpha Stocks newsletter account for next week's stock candidates and all the forecasts. Coming up after the break, more GoldSeek.com radio with Doug Casey and Roger Tutterow. So we want you to stay with us here at GoldSeek. Okay, it's great to be back with you for another GoldSeek.com Radio Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Professor Roger Tutterow from Mercer University's Stetson Business College. Roger Tutterow, Professor of Economics at Mercer University with a passion for economic modeling and forecasting. Welcome back, Dr. Tutterow.
Always nice to be with you, Chris.
You know, I'd like to begin, if we could, with the housing recovery. Given the Fed's QE operations with purchases, you know, of at least $1 trillion in toxic mortgage-backed securities and related debt, I mean, housing is obviously a vital component to this nascent economic recovery. And according to the St. Louis Fed's data, new housing starts have rebounded from the 2008 recession lows, but only to levels previously seen in the early 1990s. You know, in February, U.S. housing starts did decline. Analysts were blaming the cold weather as a culprit. In February, though, we have also seen sales of existing homes decline a bit on an annualized rate.
Yeah, clearly housing is continuing to rebound. The interesting point, though, is we have to put it in a larger context. And if you look from peak to trough, new home construction dropped on average by about 80% nationwide, some more in certain markets, particularly in the Southeast and on the West Coast. So one of the problems with dropping 80% is when you come down that far, you're going to have to grow for many, many, many years to get back toward normal. When I speak to business groups, I like to point out to them that when you drop 80%, you've got to go back up 400% to get back to where you were. And so even when you're adding 20-25% gains per year, that takes a while. And to some degree, the big percentage changes we're seeing on the housing market are an artifact of working off that low base. Yes, housing is recovering, but it's going to take quite a while. And even when we get back to normal, that doesn't mean going back to 2003, 2005 employment levels, or I should say housing start levels.
Well, your track record for forecasting the sector has been impressive right here in real time on the show. And, you know, there's another economist with a successful track record, and that's Robert Shiller at Yale. He has, I think, a less sanguine outlook on the sector. Of course, he's maintained that, obviously, for at least 14 years now. Who's ultimately going to be proven correct here?
Well, I tell you, you got to give Professor Shiller credit for his track record. You know, first off, in the equity market back during the run-up in the latter part of the 1990s, he was actually the guy that coined irrational exuberance. And then again, in the housing bubble, he had provided a pretty good call when he thought things were getting a little bit frothy. And then, of course, we're all familiar with the Case-Shiller Index itself, which is still probably kind of the gold standard for measuring how home prices have been doing. And we are seeing home prices come back, and almost all the 20 major markets are off their floors. But again, there's very few markets that are back to where they were at the peak, Dallas and Denver being two exceptions. Most markets have still some work to do to get back to where they are. I think that Professor Shiller is typically a little bit cautious, but I think that he probably has been proven right time and time again. And I think that we have to understand that when we talk about recovery in housing, we don't mean jumping back to what was really the fastest pace of expansion in my lifetime. We mean returning to something that's probably a little bit more sustainable.
That's well said. And, you know, Dallas, kind of an interesting scenario. When I talk to listeners, readers, subscribers in that town, I mean, we hear that they had quite a debt-related bubble in housing back in the 90s, and they learned their lesson, apparently, so they didn't take on quite so much debt. Another key metric Fed officials monitor closely, I think, is national unemployment. One of the best metrics, the weekly jobless claims, has declined to a three-month low, but, you know, we still see that stubborn unemployment, national unemployment, employment rate ticking a bit higher. We're above the Fed's target, 6.5% rate. There's been a little bit of dissent among the Fed ranks here lately over whether QE operations are necessary. I'd like your thoughts.
Well, I think the Fed is probably trying to back away from that 6.5% threshold that they had set out, originally arguing that they would keep short-term rates at very, very historically low levels as long as rates stayed above 6.5% and provided inflation stayed well in check. I think that part of the problem is there's a recognition that the unemployment rate has dropped, but it's some part of that reduction is due to decreases in the participation rate. I don't think that you can compare today's reading in the mid to high sixes with what a similar reading would have been back in before the Great Recession. I think part of what the Fed's going to have to do is they're looking for a way to gradually work their way out the door in terms of bond buying, and then they're going to have to wrestle with how do they gradually remove the liquidity they pumped in the economy without dumping the bonds they picked up back on the market. And probably the last issue to hit is, of course, the policy rates, although certainly more recent Fed comments, particularly from Chairman Yellen last week, has probably woken some people up to the idea the short-term rates are going to come up earlier than some analysts were looking for.
You know, in February, the U.S. industrial output increased sharply, much higher than expectations. Manufacturing does seem to be a bit more robust here. I mean, it certainly accounts for a huge proportion of our industrial production here in the United States. Some are calling this the biggest gain in U.S. manufacturing output in over 6 months. I'd like your thoughts on how this might be important.
Well, we tend to see some volatility in the month-to-month readings on industrial production. About 85% of it is manufacturing, the balance being mining and utilities. Over the longer run, I am actually bullish on manufacturing coming back to our country. One of the reasons is that as labor costs have come up in Asia, we started to see the differential between what it costs to produce here versus Asia starting to be squeezed. And that's exactly what modern economic trade theory would suggest, is that when you have free trade, you tend to get equalization of factor prices across countries. And I think that there have been a variety of academic studies over the last 24 months that say that more businesses are looking at reshoring production because that labor differential is becoming more compressed. That having been said, where a lot of the manufacturing gains are going to be, it will be in more capital-intensive production processes where the labor that is required for that will probably be a little bit of a higher skill set. So what is probably not racing right back is the manufacturing where low-skilled labor is able able to command the kind of wages that they did maybe 20 years ago.
Interesting. Well, that's going to require a sea change, I think, in education in order to retool, you know, the intellectual capital required to fit that void there. Interesting. I also wanted to move on to the inflation numbers. CPI did increase a bit, but you know, for the most part, it seemed to have been offset recently by the decline in oil and particularly gasoline prices. I mean, most of our listeners do have to pay the grocery bills each week, and this is where we're seeing substantial price appreciation. What are your thoughts here on the typical, the middle class, the working? Obviously, seeing huge increases in insurance, education, food, and related expenses. What do you think the Fed can do? Do they have ample wiggle room here to keep rates low, or eventually are they going to have to increase rates?
Well, at some point they will. I mean, and keep in mind that when we talk about cutting the quantitative easing or cutting the bond buying by $10 billion in a month, we're really just talking about taking it from $65 or $55 billion down. So we're still in a very, very accommodative monetary policy. It's hard when you're looking at a federal funds rate essentially at zero and you're still buying that many bonds after more than tripling the size of your balance sheet to call the current policy anything but accommodative. It hasn't shown up in terms of inflation yet, but also it's important to keep in mind that the earlier advocates for the idea that monetary expansion causes inflation, folks like Milton Friedman from the University of Chicago, would always point out that it's actually the money supply you keep an eye on. And for the most part, what has happened is as the Fed has raised the monetary base, we've seen the money multiplier move in the opposite direction. So while they have injected a lot of reserves in the banking system, until we really start to see all that show up as increased loans, it really isn't money supply and probably is not inflationary until that occurs.
We look at the banks that have received much of this stimulus-related money, and as I know most people know by now, they're not lending. I mean, they're holding on. They're either investing, my guess is, in T-bills or in highly risk-averse opportunities there. Essentially, that money seems to be tied up. What's it going to take to loosen the lending reins?
Well, you know, in defense of the bankers, a couple caveats. First, most of the bankers you talk to will tell you that they actually perceive there to be less loan demand than they would consider desirable. If you look at the Federal Reserve Senior Officer Lending Survey, certainly there's been some uptick in demand, but it really loan demand has been suppressed for quite a while because, candidly, businesses in particular aren't going to borrow money unless they are very confident that they can deploy it in ways that increase shareholder value. And so I think that one of the things to understand is when we don't see a lot of loan creation, part of it may be on the supply side, but a good bit is on the demand side as well. And then the other supply consideration is the banks are still working their way through a new regime in terms of regulation. We're now wrestling with what the final implications of Basel III Accords will be, whether banks will have to actually carry more capital, and they certainly will, but in terms of the buffer, they're trying to figure out exactly how much extra capital they will have to carry going forward. And a lot of bankers are wrestling with issues about how they may have to estimate and reserve against loans in a way that they did not have to in the past. And essentially, we're still kind of working through some of those methodologies. So I think once you consider the new regulatory world in which the financial institutions are working and couple that with the fact that the loan demand from businesses and consumers doesn't appear to be too robust, I think it's pretty understandable why we haven't seen it show up completely in the loan numbers yet.
I'd like to know your stance on the Glass-Steagall Act. Many folks have pointed to it recently as the a major driving factor behind the 2008-2009 credit crisis, simply because the barriers that were put in place around the Great Depression that essentially kept our major banking institutions from colluding with the investment side of the equation. We've lost that barrier, and some folks are concerned that now that we've opened up that Pandora's box, it could lead to constant repeats of the 2008 credit crisis situation. Any thoughts?
Well, I think you're right in terms of the importance of breaking down Glass-Steagall. I mean, what it essentially had done for decades was segment the banking world between commercial banks and investment banks. When the Glass-Steagall came down in the latter part of the 90s, it really did kind of blur that distinction in a significant way. I think part of the problem is, you know, and I'm torn on this one because I am a free market guy who believes that you have to have a very high threshold in terms of burden to put in place regulation to prohibits business activity. And the problem, though, is you've got an interesting situation in which the FDIC is in insuring the deposits of JOKU citizens and businesses at these institutions. And so the question becomes, do you want to allow institutions to benefit from deposit insurance at the same time that they're taking the kinds of risks, perhaps with their own capital, perhaps with some of their clients' capital they take on the investment banking side? And I think that's really historically been the argument for supporting Glass-Steagall-type barriers. I think it would be very hard at this point to separate out the functions within the banking sector. So I think, you know, we're the early parts of trying to redefine how we separate commercial and investment banking activities, even within the same organizations.
Fed tapering was a major component, a big factor in the precious metals reaction over the past 2 years. I'd be remiss if I don't try to get your outlook and try to find out what your models are saying regarding gold and silver. Now that tapering, I think, is factored into the markets, investors, they're shifting their focus away to the more traditional safe haven characteristics and inflation-related buffering characteristics of the precious metals sector. For instance, we're also seeing tensions between Western powers and Russia over Crimea. And according to a recent Telegraph report, there is the potential for a new Cold War unfolding there. I'd like to know what your models are indicating with regard to the precious metals, please.
I think, you know, over the long run, we believe that real assets, hard assets, which would include precious metals, tend to provide some hedge against inflationary pressures. I think also, though, in the case of a metal such as gold, you tend to see it serve somewhat as a safe haven. So typically in times, particularly of international crisis, you may see some flight toward gold. Over the longer run, though, I tend to believe that, you know, what it does is what most real asset prices do, which is that it moves in response to deteriorations of the value of the currency. And since we haven't, as of yet at least, seen a lot of inflation show up, particularly at the consumer level, I probably have not seen gold, you know, be flocked to quite as much as maybe it had, as some people had seen in the past. A lot of the run-up in gold probably had to do with rising concerns about the general health of the economy 4 or 5 years ago. We've given back some of the gains over the past 12 to 18 months, although it is still very much elevated versus where we were at pre-crisis levels.
Well, we want to thank you very much for your economic insights today, and I guess the best thing we can do is just try to direct our listeners and their progeny over to the Stetson Business School at Mercer University.
Do appreciate it, Chris. Always nice to be with you.
Okay, it's great to be back with you for another GoldSeek.com Radio Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Doug Casey from Casey Research. Welcome back.
Well, it's my pleasure. Thank you.
Now, you're on record recently with a call for higher prices worldwide. Others expect the Fed to continue tapering. They've done so three times now. Who do you think will ultimately be correct here? Will it be the deflationists or the inflationists?
It's been a battle, a titanic battle between inflation and deflation that's been going on since the devaluation of the dollar in 1971, when the final link was gold and therefore the final restraint on how many currency units they could create was broken. One thing you can rest assured of, I think, is that we're facing some type of a financial catastrophe. And whether it's deflationary in nature or inflationary or both in sequence is still an open question. They've greatly increased since the Greater Depression, and I do call it the Greater Depression, started in 2007, is they've greatly increased their creation of currency units. Now, for a while, it was running $85 billion per month of new money where the Fed would buy paper, mortgage paper, government debt paper, all kinds of things, and credit the accounts of the sellers with the new dollars that they created. Now they've reduced that to $65 billion temporarily, but still, they're greatly increasing. It's hard to say. The one thing they are doing is they're discouraging people from saving because it makes no sense to save with 1% interest rates because that's part of the raison d'etre for what they're doing is to decrease interest rates, hoping for people to consume more. And they're creating bubbles. Right now, the biggest bubble in the world is in the bond market. This is potentially a much bigger catastrophe than the bubble they created in the stock market, which collapsed in 2001, or the bubble they created in real estate, which collapsed in 2007. So is it going to be inflation or deflation, or both at once in separate sectors of the economy, or in sequence? Still an open question. Just look for financial chaos.
Chaos has certainly increased. I'm sure you've noticed in the past couple of decades, for the most part, we don't see these steady long-term trends that persisted over the last 30, 40 years. But there is one place that had remained stable, and that's the bond market. Are you watching that market for signs of cracks in the foundation?
The world is much more indebted now than it was even in 2007, when things very nearly came unglued, but were papered over by the creation of trillions of new dollars in the U.S., and the same thing in Europe and Japan and China. So they've reduced interest rates to near zero levels. And as interest rates go down, the prices of bonds move inversely. They've gone up. So at some point, interest rates are going to go back up. You've got to remember that interest rates were, even for U.S. government paper, depending on the length and the type, they range from 13, 14, 15, even 18% back in the early 80s. Now they're close to zero, or 1 or 2%. Interest rates, after going down for over 30 years, will eventually head back up, and that'll collapse the bond market. And all the people that are borrowing money now, borrowing for cars and for houses, won't be able to afford those things. So we'll have a resumption of the Great Depression, more unemployment, bankruptcies, corporate failures. So we're just in the eye of the storm at the moment. We entered the storm in 2007. Now we're in the eye of the hurricane, but we're going to come out very soon, I think, to the trailing edge of the hurricane, and it's going to be much, much worse and more turbulent and much, much longer lasting than what we saw in 2008 and 2009.
Well, you know, I think that's an interesting transition into the next question. You know, inflation is certainly good for precious metals. The sector tends to outperform most other competing asset classes when prices are on the rise. Do you expect the metals to retest the 2011 bull market zenith, or will we remain within this broad consolidation and trading range for several more years?
I think it's wise to put these prices in perspective. And in 2001, I was on record as saying that both gold and silver in 2001, when they were about $250 and about $4 respectively, were cheaper in real terms than they were in 1971, before the devaluation, when you could buy them both at $35 and $1.29. They were actually cheaper then. Since then, their prices have gone up, gold from $250 to $1,900, and now it's backed off. So it's not at the giveaway levels that it was back in 2001, basically the cheapest levels in history, even though it was selling at $250 an ounce. But at $1,300 or whatever it is at the moment, it's a very reasonable value, and you should be buying for reasons of prudence and safety and insurance, not necessarily capital gains and speculative gains, as was possible 10 or 12 years ago. But that said, I'm a buyer. It's going to go higher in both real and nominal terms, because there's going to be a panic into precious metals at some point as people want to get out of these debasing paper currencies. And this is true not just of the dollar, but of all paper currencies around the world.
We're in a much different world than we were, obviously, about 35 years ago, the last bull market peak in 1980. Nowadays, we do have ETFs. If your worst-case scenario does come to pass as outlined, would you expect for the paper schemes, if you will, to lose their efficacy at shielding investors from higher prices?
When it comes to ETFs, most of them, I don't know whether they actually have the gold in vaults that they add to as people put more money into the ETFs, or whether They're just hedging themselves in the futures market. So I prefer the physical metal, not a promise from some third party out there who may or may not have the financial wherewithal to make good if the market goes the wrong way on them. But the answer to the question is that first and foremost, everybody should buy physical gold in their own possession and keep it in the second safest place they can think of. So that's the foundation. The second level would be to have more physical gold outside your home country, because it's critical to diversify internationally, diversify politically, because the political dangers in the world are even greater than the investment dangers. So have some of your gold outside of your home country. A third level is you can use things like goldmoney.com or the Hard Assets Alliance, and they'll store the gold for you in physical form outside your home country. And then for trading purposes, not a long-term holding, then use the ETFs. So I put them last on the term pole, and as I said, for short-term speculation only.
You know, for lower net worth individuals, there are some interesting new options to move precious metals offshore without having to go through the tedious process of selling what you own currently and then having to repurchase in another country. Apparently, Brinks has an excellent program now in place with the Brinks Vault in Montreal, as well as other Canadian vaults as well. And just the small net worth individual can pay as little as $20, $30 a month and have their, let's say, 10 silver 100-ounce bars in Montreal. So I just wanted to toss this out there for our listeners today who maybe are interested in dipping their toe in the water. It's not as diversified as, let's say, Panama or Switzerland or something of that nature, but it might get the ball rolling in the event that capital controls were to become more strict, as many folks are forecasting. Gold stocks are typically viewed as leveraged gold and silver plays. So far, 2014 is shaping up to be one of the best years in quite some time for XAU. It's certainly a robust sector. Tell folks what has renewed your interest in the precious metal stocks, please.
First of all, the mining stocks should not be considered investments. They're really speculations. This is why Benjamin Graham never talked about them in his book, and why Warren Buffett never deals with them. There's too much unpredictability about them. And basically, gold mining is not, quote-unquote, like owning a gold mine. It's really become a volatile, low-margin, unpredictable business. They're speculations. They're not investments. That said, the volatility of mining stocks is a good thing, not a bad thing, because the sector that I'm interested in is the mining exploration stocks, most of which, incidentally, I've got to say, are worthless. But still, they trade, and they're extraordinarily volatile. It's possible to get returns of 10 to 1, 50 to 1, 100 to 1, and I hate to say it, but it's true, 1,000 to 1. And as we speak now, they're just coming off of their lowest bottom in history, in real terms. So the odds favor people that speculate in them now doing extremely well in the next few years. So I'm very friendly towards them, and I'm buying them.
Excellent. That'll be music to our listeners' ears. You've also noticed in recent discussions that the world's banking system is bankrupt, that the central banks do still own the electric printing presses, so we must start producing real goods and services, not just stocks and financial products. Could you tell us more, please?
One comment I've got to make is that the entire financial sector of the world is greatly overblown. Something like 22% of the market value of the world's stock markets is in banks, brokerage firms, and other financial institutions. I don't know what, if we lived in a free market, that percentage would be, but my guess is like fraction, perhaps 10% of what it is, like 2% of the value of markets, because banks and brokers don't produce anything. They just shuffle money. And one of the problems in an inflationary economy that we're in right now, so it's inflated this whole area, the whole finance. It's a bubble. And one thing I don't want to touch right now are bank stocks and brokerage stocks. Most of them are bankrupt, and their market values are way out of proportion to what it seems to me they would be in a free market society. In addition to the fact that, at least until recently, when kids have started to realize that going to college is almost certainly a misallocation of their time and money, everybody wanted to become a banker, which is another sign of a bubble in the area.
You're also calling for a greater depression, worse than the 1930s, and that there is just a mound of personal, corporate, and federal debt that could capsize the entire system. Folks have just been living beyond their means. I wonder if you could highlight what listeners should expect under this scenario and maybe some precautions that could be taken right now.
Well, yes, let me define the word depression. It's a word that's used occasionally, not too much. People don't like to even think about a depression, so they call it a recession. But a depression is a period of time when most people's standard of living drops significantly. From that point of view, I'd say that we definitely entered what I call the Greater Depression in 2007. And debt is a real indicator of financial problems. Why? Because when you have debt, it means that you've been either consuming capital that somebody else has saved in the past, or you're mortgaging your future and money that you'll earn in the future. Savings is a sign that you've been producing more than you're consuming and setting that aside. Debt is a sign that you've been consuming more than you're producing. And so with the world in debt, as much as it is, it means that we've been living out of capital or mortgaging our future. It's a potential catastrophe when everybody realizes it's run over the edge of the cliff and there's nothing below them. And that's where we are right now. I don't see any way back or around without a real reset in the world's financial and economic system. It's very, very serious, this debt thing.
It certainly is. And, you know, one way outside of the debt system, at least some pundits have pointed to, is gold. I mean, it's certainly been the go-to asset class of the last 15 years or so. But even the most staunch gold investor, they've lost their conviction. It's been shaken at least somewhat since 2011. I wonder if you could tell listeners how these discounted prices could be better than we did in the early stage of the last two gold markets.
Well, look, I really like to buy things when they're cheap, not when they're expensive. And I really like to try to be, it's hard to be, but I like to try to be a contrarian. And I don't like to chase trends after they've been going on for too long and there's a mania building up. And the important thing to remember about gold is it's the only financial asset that's not simultaneously somebody else's liability. And in a world with a quadrillion, that's to say $1,000 trillion worth of derivatives floating around there, giant daisy chains where somebody owes somebody else and owes somebody else and owes somebody else, the whole system could come apart from one default or two defaults, and then it's a daisy chain. And that's why you want gold, because it's a financial asset that's not somebody else's liability. And we don't know exactly how much gold there is above ground in the world, but a very fair guess is about 6 billion ounces have been mined in all of history. In other words, something less than 1 ounce for every human being on the planet. So when you look at it that way, and you take the, that's one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it is you look at the number of U.S. dollars that, let's say, just the U.S. dollars outside of the United States, which people don't have to own, which the Americans do, but foreigners hold it just for their convenience. Say about 8 trillion U.S. dollars outside the U.S. Just if those dollars were to be redeemed with gold, you do the division, And you're looking at a big number, not counting the dollars inside the U.S. So I have to be bullish on gold. I'm just forced to be.
Well, you also say that the 2008 credit crisis was merely an interlude to a far more devastating economic plunge. We're still in the biggest bubble in world history, you've said, bigger than even the tech stock market bubble around the turn of the last century. It's bigger than even the real estate bubble or the bond bubble. Interest rates ranging from 0 to a few percent. This is the biggest bubble in history, and when it collapses, you've said it's going to be catastrophic because the bond market is so large. Please elaborate.
Yes, and the bond market is the largest market in the world. And since all the governments of the world, almost all, I had a few exceptions, government of Norway, the government of Singapore, there are a few others, but really all the governments of the world are bankrupt. They have liabilities and obligations that they've promised their subjects vastly in excess of the capital they have to make good on them. So this is why they're printing up currencies. And incidentally, all the central banks in the world have U.S. dollars and U.S. Treasury securities as major backing for their own currencies. So if the U.S. dollar blows up, it's going to take all the other currencies around the world down with it. And it's going to be a worldwide thing. In other words, I live in Argentina a good part of the year, and I love it. Fantastic country to live in. The government here is in their economic policies, but it doesn't bother me at all. It inures to my benefit. So the point I'm making is this. If the financial system in Argentina blows up, so what? It's just one little country, and foreigners take advantage of that by bringing capital in and buying things at bargain prices. No problem. However, if the United States blows up, it's a very different thing because U.S. paper underlies all the other world currencies. And if that blows up, everybody loses their savings in the banking system. And corporations go bankrupt. The stocks become worthless. It'll become a worldwide phenomenon. So this is potentially much more serious than what the world faced in the 1930s. Much more serious. This is bigger than the tulip bubble in Europe, in addition to the fact that all these governments, when things go wrong, they tend to want to blame somebody else. And it's most convenient to blame another country for bringing the price of oil over $100 a barrel, for creating all kinds of cheap, good products for people to buy, putting American workers out of business because they're too inefficient to compete with them. So this is how wars start. And this is another element in the witch's brew.
Anything else that you're watching closely? Any other sectors that might be of particular interest?
Almost everything in the world is overpriced. Real estate's still overpriced because of, certainly in the U.S. and the developed world, because it floats on a sea of debt, which makes it very, very dangerous still. Stocks worldwide are, by all historic parameters, price earnings ratio, price to book value ratio, very overpriced. I have no interest in them in general. And of course, bonds are a terminal short sale. That said, there are always anomalies. For instance, on the Mongolian Stock Exchange, there's a little stock that's trading that's investing heavily in North Korea. You can buy it for a small fraction of its book value. Small market cap, it's hard to buy something on the Mongolian Stock Exchange, but there are anomalies like that around there. Well, just recently, price of coffee has doubled, and I thought that it was a fantastic pair trade to be long coffee, this was some months ago, and short Starbucks, and that worked out very well. So there's always speculative opportunities like that, and there will be more of them in the future. But right now, in general, I'd say you've got to be in these small gold mining stocks. They're really, really cheap, and it's likely that there's going to be a mania created in them over the next few years, cyclically.
I wonder if you could give the listeners an idea of some of the parameters that you like to watch when choosing. It could be a challenging sector to find those rare nuggets that do return as much as 100 to 1,000 fold the initial investment. The typical parameters that folks look for, the key ratios and financial metrics, it's just not adequate for pretty much separating the wheat from the chaff. Could you give folks an idea?
Yeah, no, you're quite correct about that. You can't use conventional security analysis in dealing with these things. They're generally a black hole for money. So we've developed what we call the eight P's that we always look at when we look at any of these little stocks. And there are about, I don't know how many, maybe 3,000 in the world. Most of them are traded in Canada, secondarily in the UK, Australia, and the US. Say 3,000 of them. And they all have gold or some other element to their name, but that's only on the share certificate. It's very rarely in the ground. And these eight P's we look at, it's a mnemonic. The first thing is people. We always look at the people in back of it. Are they competent? Are they honest? Do we know them personally, know how they think? This is by far the most critical thing. And you've got to have boots on the ground to be able to solve that part of the equation. Second thing is property. You've got to have some degree of geological competence where you can look at their property and see if it's possible that they have an economic resource there. Not just a resource, some element in the ground, but an economic resource that can be extracted profitably. Politics. I mean, what part of the world are they in? Is the government and the NGOs going to make it even possible or economic to mine this stuff? Financing, spelled with a PH, because this is a mnemonic. Can they raise the money to do this? Because it's no longer a question with mining of a couple guys with a mule going out and finding the treasure of Sierra Madre. This is a high-tech business, and it takes millions of dollars to do the prospecting with geophysics and geochemistry and so forth. Very different than it used to be. So there are a number of these things that we look at, and they're different to some degree than conventional securities analysis.
Very good. Well, we appreciate your time today. I wonder if you might tell listeners any contact information as well as the host of services that you provide.
Well, the name of the company is Casey Research. And if you go on our website, which is caseyresearch.com, we have a number of free publications, and they're actually extremely good, I've got to tell you. They're really, I'm very happy with them. And you can sign up for the free publications. And if you like the free publications and you agree with the way that we think, you might want to sign up for one of the investment recommendation publications. And I have a lot of videos on YouTube and so forth that go into the things we've been talking about in a different way and different angle. But this has been a very good interview. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Well, the pleasure is all ours, and we certainly hope that you'll return to GoldSeek.com radio soon.
Well, thanks for having me on.
Chris, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. The Russian annexation of Crimea, the threat of escalating economic sanctions, the missing Malaysian airliner, a punchline that has not yet been written or shared with a growing and fixated global audience. Are these separate events? Or are they interrelated? When Russia engages in a direct military engagement, instead of through a surrogate country, it's a big deal. There was Hungary in 1956, Czechoslovakia in 1968, Afghanistan in 1979, and now the annexation of Crimea in 2014. The threat of military action in the Ukraine exists, and the appropriate saber-rattling is taking place, with military exercises, sanction threats, and a host of other financial warfare strategies that would be disruptive for global business and international travel. Could it happen? Yes, it could. Will it happen? We'll have to wait and see. But remember, Putin has already authorized the annexation of Crimea. Maybe that's enough of a prize already, at least for now. What's equally, if not more disturbing, is the missing Malaysian airliner. Not just the fact that it's missing, but how all news broadcasts, radio, television, alternative media, conversations with family and friends, all seem to revolve around this story. A story without an ending or a punchline as of this moment in time. Why do you think this kind of tabloid journalism has been allowed to run rampant on a story that should be engineering and aeronautically focused? Why are networks jumping to political agendas and playing wild speculating games of what if, asking questions and role-playing scenarios about what countries the plane could be in and what we might have to do if it turned out to be true? I believe it was Chicago's mayor, Rahm Emanuel, who said, "Never let a good crisis go to waste." This crisis is being exploited for every possible political and military agenda. Don't people realize when they are being played? Do we really believe no one in an official capacity doesn't already know where the plane went and is currently located? Would acknowledging such information expose the presence of classified military facilities that Malaysia would rather pretend it does not possess? Or is the missing plane the ultimate loaded gun, silently pointed at the head of Russia, in case it really does invade the Ukraine? The next false flag attack could be anywhere in the world. For over a week, citizens of the globe have fixated their attention on a missing aircraft and have been led to believe the conclusion could be any one of 100 different scenarios. If Russia invades the Ukraine, do the powers that be narrow those options to one conclusion? One that includes Russian involvement? And then attempt to galvanize global support for military confrontation with Russia? A variation of this worked on 9/11. And like it or not, it will work in this situation too. And if I'm thinking about it, many others are as well. And until next time, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com, reminding you to follow us on Twitter @ConquerChange. Thanks, Chris.